Welcome to A Celtic State of Mind. I'm Paul John Dykes, and this week's guest is journalist Hugh MacDonald. Hugh knows the Scottish game inside out, having worked at the sharp end of journalism for over 40 years. He's also a self-confessed Celtic fan, and he offers a great insight here into Fergus McCann, Gordon Strachan, and Neil Lennon, amongst others. It was interesting for me to get Hugh's take on the rise of fan media from a mainstream perspective, and I'm sure you will enjoy our discussion as well as Hugh's choice of music. Be sure to subscribe to Celtic State of Mind on iTunes, Acast, Spreaker and YouTube. Spread the word, leave a review, follow us on Twitter at AxonPod, at Paul Dykes and at A Northern Prose, and get involved. The podcast is expanding. We are building our own website, have more than 40 guests lined up for the show, and we'll also be capturing a lot more content on video throughout the coming season. As well as our staple, A Celtic State of Mind podcast, which includes in-depth interviews like the one you're about to hear with Hugh MacDonald, we will have two additional podcasts throughout the 2018-19 season and beyond. First up, the Axon Bulletin will be a roundup of the various Celtic-related events that Kevin Graham and I attend, with discussions being brought to you mainly by my right-hand man Kevin, who loves a natter. So approach him if you do see him at a game or an event. Chances are that he'll have his recording gear in tow. We're also delighted to announce that we will have a regular Sunday night show called The Captain's Table, where ex-Celtic skipper Andy Lynch joins us to offer his analysis and opinion on the week's events concerning Celtic. We are all about creating quality content for Celtic fans, and in order to develop A Celtic State of Mind the way we planned from the very offset, we felt the need to go it alone. We are currently arranging a launch night for our new site, which will include a mixture of live football discussion with an ex-Celt or Celts, as well as exclusive film footage and live music. Tickets will be extremely limited, so get in touch via our social media channels if you want to get involved. We'll be announcing more details very soon. Thank you for all your ongoing support for the podcast. Now sit back and enjoy Hugh MacDonald with A Celtic State of Mind.
There's two points with social media and fans writing. I think fans writing is a great thing. It can give you, there's some really good fans writing out there, some really good blogs, interesting, intriguing. There's also blogs and stuff that give you a hint of what's going on for a journalist. Some of them have got excellent sources. The Rangers tax case, hugely intriguing blog, hugely intriguing. Even, there'll be arguments about, they got the final judgment wrong and all that, although later the judgment was of course vindicated, and arguments maybe about little precise things, but not for me. I just think all these blogs are just add to the weight and the human knowledge. But what you've got to do with them is you've got to be reading them with some kind of rigour. And sometimes you're reading stuff and you know that this is just wrong because you're working in a journalistic field, and they'll say, for instance, there'll be blogs that will go on and say, so-and-so, insert name here, a PR chief, has given this story to so-and-so, and they're working hand-in-glove in this. And you know that so-and-so and so-and-so hate each other with a level that the guy wouldn't give, the old expression, nod in the desert, comes to mind. But even, this is just not on, this just can't happen. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The level of antipathy between these people is such that this invalidates the whole blog. It's like, you look at it and you go, well, do you know something? If you don't know that, how much do you really know? Because this is so essential. I mean, this is like basic journalism in Scotland. If you think these two guys are working in cahoots, and I'm not talking about conspiracies, I know these two guys. I know how they feel about each other. This just isn't happening. So you wonder about other things. The other things that blogs can get away with, and it's this lazy mainstream media, is they can see things and make allegations that as a professional journalist you can't. And I'm not just talking about legally, although that's a huge thing, because legally you had to adhere to service, but I mean reputationally. Mm-hmm. So there's certain things in blogs which I could bring up and cite that celebrated bloggers have said dogmatically certain things. I've went away and checked them, and they were proved wrong at the time. And then for a period of 3 weeks, 6 weeks, you say these are just extraordinarily wrong, absolutely. But if you were in mainstream journalism, you'd be known as the man that had said X, Y, and Z. You see it now with certain journalists that are labelled, well, you were the man that said that and that. Bloggers don't tend to get that. Bloggers tend to get praised for what they got right rather than the massive stuff, which was wrong. But that's fair enough. I don't mind that. That's the world we're in. I've got no... As I say, I'm very at ease with blogging. But what I'm saying is there's got to be a health warning about it. You've got to look at it rigorously. You've got to look at it from your own perspective. You've got to say to yourself, wait a wee minute here. This can't be true. And check it and find out it's not. Some stuff you just don't have to check because you know the people involved and you know it just wouldn't happen. And other stuff you get is there's been great insights. You say, goodness me, how did they know that? And how did they get that? And the sources. But by and large, with the guys, the big bloggers, I'll say this to the listener. See, and we know when you're reading a blog and you want to know who's put the story out, if it's a revelatory story, there's a great Latin phrase and it's cui bono, and it means who benefits from the story goes out. And if you ask yourself that question, you're probably really in the same postcode as who put that story out.
Yeah, the big thing for me is this clickbait. It's a terminology that is used a hell of a lot, but that's because there is a lot of it. And I feel that, you know, that people can fall into the trap, Hugh, of having a headline that's deliberately controversial or misleading so that they get the click into the story. And then obviously there's an ad revenue or a monetization element to it.
Yeah, that's a huge problem for not just for blogging and non-mainstream journalism. It's a huge problem for mainstream journalism, Paul. I went through huge arguments when I was like a full-time journalist with that kind of stuff. Like, you had to have a real rigour of what you were doing as a headline. It's all right, and you had to have a rigour what you're doing as a comment piece. Now, I've written comment pieces that were pretty incendiary. I mean, just off the top of my head, I remember writing a comment piece about, you know, Gordon Strachan and dropping Aidan McGeady for a game at Ibrox, which was really on the verge of, you know, almost like, you know, out of order. I mean, it was really strong on that. But I felt so strongly about it, and I tried to keep it, I did keep it within legal rights and all that. But that would be a great hit piece, because everybody would say, oh, look, there's anger. You can only do that every now and again, because you have to be, there has to be a sort of, not to use too pious a word, there has to be a righteousness about it. You must feel this is worth going on about. Why did Celtic lose the league? They lost the league, you know, partly for a myriad of reasons, but losing the Ibrox would be one of them. Why did he not then pick Aidan McGeady, who was man of the match against Rangers 2 weeks previously, instead pick him from starting 11, little Sean Maloney, who hadn't kicked a ball for, literally hadn't kicked a ball for 6 months, hadn't played for since December. So you go in with the baseball back there, you know, and Wee Gordon was incandescent about the piece, and that's fair enough. So he should be, and I could take that in the chin. But if you keep doing that so often, people say to yourself, this guy's just angry at everything. You know, he's just like, he can't stop being angry at this thing. So you've got to choose it. But people, there would be now, there's an element of, yeah, let's be this pantomime dame or pantomime villain. Hammer, 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 hammer. And you see with the pundits now, I mean, punditry at one time was very wishy-washy. It was always maybe this and maybe that, and oh, he'll be disappointed with himself and all that. Now you get the punditry, which is, you know, this guy is shameful, he shouldn't do this again, this guy should never darken. So, and that, there's a lot of pressure on people to bring clicks in.
You know, you mentioned there the reaction, Gordon Strachan. I always remember in a different type of journalism, but I always remember reading that Paul Weller, if he ever had a bad review, be it an album or a live gig, he would contact the journalist and he would question him about it quite vehemently. When you're a journalist, credible journalist, and you think you're writing what you're going to put out there, like the Strachan story you mentioned, does it ever cross your mind that there's going to be a breakdown in a relationship that you might rely on later on?
Absolutely. And it's very important to remember that not everybody's got the luxury of being that outspoken. And it is a luxury. You're blessed if you're when I was chief sports writer, the Herald, that I would have a, there'd be a certain cachet to that position where they were not looking for you to phone up Gordon Strachan at 10:30 at night and ask him if he's signing Buram Kayal or he's selling Buram Kayal and Gordon telling you. They wouldn't expect that from him. So your relationship with Gordon then would not have to be sacrosanct. You wouldn't, and what happens with a lot of people, if you're working the beat, you've got to remember that one time you might be asking this guy for a favour and you're burning bridges. And it's to the credit, I mean, it's easier for me, I always said it was easier for me to burn bridges than for maybe a guy who's the, or a woman who's a Celtic reporter, who's on the Celtic beat for a newspaper. It's much easier for me than them. I mean, they're talking maybe burning the only contact that really matters to them. Full
yeah.
stop.
Yeah.
I mean, like Gordon Strachan will matter more to the than anybody else in the world contact wise. Mm-hmm. They could burn their contacts book and ask for one number, and it would obviously, maybe it'd be Peter Lawwell or something. But you know what I mean? That would be that'd be a priority, that you could be able to look the manager in the eye and ask him a question and have a relationship. I was of the thing that I didn't. It wasn't essential for me. I would like to think that, oh, I'm so righteous that I would have done it anyway. Well, I don't know if I was a Celtic beat reporter, I could say pretty probably I wouldn't have, you know.
Because things would dry up, wouldn't they?
Aye, absolutely.
Yeah.
And you'd have to move out of being the Celtic beat reporter. You'd have to go to your editor and say, well, I can't interview the Celtic manager because, you know, I fell out. And by the way, I don't blame Gordon Strachan for falling out with me, because I lacerated him and he came back and lacerated me. And he was quite right to lacerate me, because I had... You know, and I'm really, Paul, see guys phoning you up and complaining about what you've written, particularly if you've been outspoken, I'm so relaxed with that. I think that, you know, I don't like it because nobody likes conflict and confrontation, but I absolutely, you know, back the right 100% to do it.
And you believed in what you wrote. So
I believed in what I wrote. He believes it's a lot of crap, and that's fine.
Yeah. I mean, another thing that's come through fairly recently through your journalistic career is I've noticed you've appeared a fair amount of times on, you know, Celtic TV, and we've spoken about Peter and Ruffy as well. So could you explain how your introduction into these shows has come about, and also the different type of reaction you've had from that, like walking down
it's quite amazing. I mean, one of the things, I was an anonymous journalist for 50, well, I've been a journalist for 45 years. I was an anonymous journalist till I was 50, and that my background in journalism was more editing. Like, I was chief sub-editor of the Herald, and I was literary editor of the Herald, and a variety of circumstances, both personal and professional, which I won't bore you with, conspired one day for somebody to come up and ask me, hey, do you want to be chief sports writer of the Herald? I'd been writing a column for a while, and I went, oh yeah, I'd love to do that. So I was 50 then, so my whole life changed. And what journalists generally, and I can say this because don't realise the exposure, particularly now with social media, that you get from the punter. Like, if you're the best financial journalist in Scotland, you maybe get 5 or 6 emails a day from people. Even get that from readers? That's nonsense. You may get 5 or 6 a week. I mean, when I was features editor or features writer of the Herald and literary editor, from the punter, 4 or 5 a week, all of them would be nice and almost always praiseworthy, or maybe just pointing out a small mistake here in a very dignified way, or maybe a wee suggestion about doing something else. When you become a sports journalist in Scotland, the whole thing changes completely. You're just lotting about a big target in your back, and it ranges from mildly irritated to invading the Sudetenland. That's the range of reactions, right? And that's on a daily basis. And some of it's really an amazing thing about Paul is that you have to, because you're a human being, and the first times it happened, you get really wounded and you try to argue with them, but I didn't say that to that. And they're saying I said that, I'll have to answer them back, and oh, they're saying this, they've got the wrong instinct, and all ego, right? Till eventually, whereas I'm always very, if somebody, even somebody slaughters me, and they do, an email, I'll go back to them and thank them for it. If it's within the bounds, if they just come on and just I mean, there's some awful stuff that you get. You just don't reply to. But if somebody's making a really good point and said, you know, I don't agree with that, and you go back and say, well, this is why I said it. But the volume of it is huge. I mean, the volume can be, if you really hit something that's a nerve, you can get scores of emails in a day.
Mm-hmm.
In a day, scores of emails in a day, Twitter notifications just go down. And by the way, I'm on the periphery of this. I'm not a Hugh Keevans or a Keith Jackson who've got these huge followings. I'm very much on the very lower end of this, but that's something, one of the things as a person, I had to change. I had to become tougher, I had to become more resilient, and now I actually look back even like the 12 years ago and go, God, how did I feel like that then? Because I just don't feel that way.
Why
did it bother me when it doesn't end? And it's because the ego thing's changed and you become more resilient. I think one of the great things they have, and I know that Hugh Keevans, who's a great pal, I mean, has this as well, you become aware of your own absurdity, which I think is a very important thing.
I've seen Hugh having a right good bit of to and fro with quite a lot of people coming on with a comment, and him being quite witty actually in his response.
Well, he's a witty guy, but he's very much aware of... See, he's slightly older than me as well, so he's lived a life. He's got children and grandchildren, and he'll have seen a bit in life. So he knows, in the essence of this, you know what? This might sound the greatest heresy and almost blasphemy in the world. It doesn't really matter that much. It really doesn't, you know. Not if you've got Waynes and Grand Waynes and brothers that are sick or, you know, whatever. You go, do you know what? It's important. I'm not decrying it. It's important to me. Football's always been a major part of my life, sport, and it's important to me. I've spent a lot of time on it. I've earned a living out of it. I read about it. I watch it. I'm not giving this high snooty thing. But at the essence of it, you've got to believe, do you know what? It's not that important. And B, I am absurd. I have spent my life, if you go through my journalistic career, from being a chief sub-editor all the way through, I've spent my life telling the government how to run the country. Telling Martin Amis how to write a novel, telling Bob Dylan to Bruce Springsteen how to write a record, and then telling people like Alec Ferguson how to pick a football team. If you do not think there's a level of absurdity in that, you're in the wrong game.
How long does it take though for that to actually dawn on you that this is an absurd kind of...
It dawned on me pretty quickly, because I was at the age of 24 and 25. I rose quite quickly and I became chief sub of the Herald, and that was a really big job at the time. It was a different culture then, and the chief sub was a very powerful person. You decided basically where everything went in the paper. The editor would come and say to you, well, you know, he had the final decision, but a lot of times it's not like that now, but it was kind of hands off. The editor might be more interested in what the leader comment was saying, or, you know, or what the political correspondent was saying in his column, rather than and reacting to what was going on news-wise. So you had a lot of that. And I used to sit and think to myself, I'm 24, and I look around the office, and if I just snap my fingers and say, right, stop the presses, and this is the days where there'd be hundreds of people employed in the Herald, there'd be 100 journalists, there'd be 100 in the case room, there'd be 50 in the machine room, there'd be 100 advertising people. You're talking about a huge operation. If I said, you know what, stop this, just everybody stop now, or stop the presses, they would have to do it. I would get, if I didn't come up with a reason for it, I mean, I would be carted off into the night, but I could do it. Mm-hmm. And I used to burst out laughing at that, because I used to say, that's just absurd to have that power. It's just like crazy. I'm just a kid, I'm 24. You know, I'm not 6 or 7 years out of school. You know, I've never been to uni, and I've got this power. And I've always been aware of that with football, because you talk to, everybody's got their football opinion and all that, and I've got mine, and I've watched a lot of football and all that. I always laugh, like, if we talk about it, very, very much now you get all these wee blogs and all that about, oh, play this theory. You know the blogs, there's, you know, people saying, young guys will say, if Ryan Jack, you know, had been available for Rangers on Sunday, you know, that this would have stopped the Celtic passing and it would be a different game and all that. And you go, no. No, for me, you know, no for me. And if you talk to the guys that really know about football, who have managed teams and had great things in football, you've got to be aware that For example, if you're writing an article about why Pep Guardiola was wrong to play Gundogan against Andrew Robertson and Manny in a European Cup semi-final, there's a good article to be written in that, because he did prove it wrong. But you've got to remember that there's just a chance, albeit a small one, that Pep Guardiola might know more about football than Hugh MacDonald. Just a sliver of a chance, right? And you've got to have that awareness when you're writing that article. You've got to have that awareness. Otherwise it's just a prune.
I read stories about, and I often speak to players who go back to a level of control that Jock Stein had, or influence, I would say, on certain Scottish media outlets. Mm-hmm. In your experience, has anybody played the press really well? You know, is there anybody who's been very, very tactical, and you've thought to yourself, these guys really get it and how the whole press works?
Yep, there's guys that really, really get it, and guys who, I mean, Stein was the... From the older guys, this is before my time, but I know the guys, like, again, going back to Hugh and Ken Gallagher, who I knew. As I say, Glenn was a great friend of mine. Roger Bailey, a great friend of mine. And the way, and Ian Paul, all these guys who would be in that mix at the time, would tell you just how cute Stein was and how revolutionary it was. Because Stein wouldn't give the Monday papers, what we call the Mondays, to let the listener understand this. After a game, there'll be a press conference, but if it's a Saturday game, as all games were in those days, it's not much use for the Monday papers. So most managers, the Monday papers would have to rehash something from somewhere. But Jock Stein would convene a meeting at, I think it was 11 a.m. at Celtic Park, and invite all the journalists on a Sunday morning. So he was giving up his time to come. And his reasoning for that was that then he was setting the agenda for the whole week on the Monday morning, because he knew the journalists would call him, because they had nothing else. They had other stuff. It would just be reheated stuff they'd have to do. So they knew that he was coming along, and he would say something. He would have literally an agenda. There's nothing dark or conspiratorial about that. As a manager of Celtic Football Club, he was wanting to get the message of Celtic Football Club into the papers on a Monday morning. Not the message of Rangers Football Club, not anything to do with Rangers Football Club, but his side of it. And he knew he had an open goal. And that was revolutionary. And that was so, so clever. Because I don't know what week you put on it, Paul, but in at least one league season, and people like Davy White will tell you, I interviewed Davy before he died, was that Steen's constant Monday morning back pages that Celtic couldn't win the league and only Rangers could throw away had a huge effect on the Rangers team. That was Davy White saying that, not Jock Stein saying how smart I am later when it happened to come to fruition. Yeah. That is, you know, Davy White said, I was a young, naive manager, and this guy was setting the agenda all the time. Only Rangers could. We are not even bothered about the league. We're professional, we'll play the game. But Rangers win the league, it's just a matter of when. And of course they didn't, Celtic. And Davy White told me categorically, he said, that played a huge part of what was going on. So, I mean, I interviewed Alec Ferguson on 50 years after Lisbon, and he said that Stein was a genius in so many ways. Obviously a football genius, and what he could come up with tactically and training-wise. I mean, stuff that Stein did that was miles before then. You know, the assembly of a wall, for example, a defensive wall, how he... We'd go into that. Things like training with a ball. We know all this stuff, fitness, preparation, motivation. He said, but the great thing was the press. And he actually, when Alec was working with him at Scotland, Stein said to him one day, you do the press conference today. And Alec said, why? He said, I want you to do a press conference. If you're going to be a top manager, you have to know how to work the press. You have to know how to work. And Alec says, another good thing was that Stein knew everything that was going on in Scottish football. Intelligence, in the other sense of the word intelligence. Yeah. Mm-hmm. He had an intelligence system. He knew. So before he went into the room, Alec would tell us, see that guy over there, he's got trouble with women. That guy's a drinker. That guy's a gambler. This guy will ask you about this because he's a Rangers man. This guy will be easy on you because he's an Aberdeen reporter and he wants you to do well. He says, could you round the room? Mm-hmm. And that... So, yeah, I mean, Stein would be the classic at that. for all the things that have been said about Alex Ferguson and his relationship with us, he worked the press brilliantly as well. You imagine the pressure he put in the press on guys like Benitez and Keegan, most famously, yeah. But others. And in Scotland, we went through a marvellous, almost purple generation of Walter Smith, who could work the press, but knew what they wanted, would give them it. And probably the greatest press conference, in my experience, the greatest press conference guy, Neil Lennon.
Right.
Lennon, I've been off the beat, so I've not been at a Brendan Rodgers press conference, but the press guys say he's brilliant at a press conference, really clever, really cute, gets what he wants across, etc. I've not been at one because now I'm just freelancing, I'm doing other things, but I probably will go to one just to witness it. But Lennon was brilliant because he was so bright, Neil, so intelligent and so brave that he'd never cared about a question. He would just answer questions straight, like questions that other people would dance around. Neil saying, yeah, you know, what do we think about referees? Well, I think the referees are rotten. I think they're the worst in Europe. He would not. But another thing is, you could be quite sharp. I mean, I always asked him once, thinking, presuming, maybe being over familiar about something. I can't remember what it was, but it was something to do a team issue. He would say, that's none of your business. So, you know, bang, could put you down. Mm-hmm. Just like, literally said to me, that's none of your business, you. Okay. And he was right, it was none of his business. But Lennon was very sharp. He could get his message across, very honest. And I think with Neil Lennon, if some one word to sum him up, both as a footballer, well, three base, footballer, manager, and character, brave.
Mm-hmm.
Brave, that would be my word.
You think, maybe perhaps for a younger journalist going into a room with somebody as brave and as strong as Neil Lennon, with that reputation, would that put them off trying to perhaps get the message across that they've been asked to get across from their own boss? Would that put a wee bit of
intimidation? Yeah, I mean, there's certainly a fear in rooms. I mean, like, the great one about Walter Smith was always famous for, we always called him the stare, because he had that stare. And if there's times where you ask a question and it'd just be the stare, and you knew where the you know, you're like the lad there. But no, I think likes of guys like Lenny would hit back at you, like that question to me, I'd be in the game for 45 years and he would just turn and say, that's none of your business. And I'm all right with that, because even if it wasn't my business, he was probably right, obviously. That's a question, he gets the answer, and I'm right, okay. But I think young journalists actually would be quite amazed about the level of, maybe not acceptance, but like respect and accommodation they get from managers. There's this thing about football managers and footballers that they're all horrible people and they're this and that. There's some horrible people, but there's some horrible people in life. Generally, when you get to know most, not all, but most managers and many footballers, you find they're okay. They're okay. If you treat them the right way, they'll treat you the right way. I mean, I'll go back to that Gordon Strachan thing where we fell out. Gordon Strachan was absolutely correct to follow. I mean, I've got no resentment whatsoever. But if I see him again, I nod to him and all this. He knows what I did, and I know he. But there's no problem there. And with players as well, I've had, you know, fallen out of players because I've had to write things about players.
Mm-hmm.
And you fall out to them. But I don't have any residual resentment towards them.
Yeah.
The only players that annoy me is like guys who arrange to meet you at times and then don't meet you, just don't turn up.
Or they're an hour late.
Oh, no, that never happens. But you know, you just don't turn up and you just go, well, you know. But by and large, no, I think I'm just going through in my head the managers of Scotland at the moment, and in my limited knowledge, you put them all in the good guy basket.
Yeah.
I've been loving you a long time,
down all the years, down all the days. And I've cried for all your troubles, smile at your funny little ways. We watched our friends grow up together, and we saw them as they fell. Some of them fell into heaven, some of them fell into hell. I took shelter from a shower, and I stepped in to your arms on a rainy night in Soho. The wind was whistling all its charms. I sang you all my sorrows. You told me all your joys. Whatever happened to that old song, to all those little girls and boys? In the morning, the ginger lady by my bed, covered in a cloak of silence, I'd hear you talking in my head. I'm not singing for the future, I'm not dreaming of the past, I'm not talking of the first times. I never think about the last. Now the song is nearly over, we may never find out what it means. Still there's a lot I hold before me. You're the measure of my dreams, the measure of my dreams.
I think Steve Clark's come across really well in everything I've seen him do since he's taken over at Kilmarnock.
But he's come across like he's come across, it's quite funny because that's an internet thing. He's come across as a grumpy old uncle and all that. But what Clark's very good at is what I call a name ranking number manager, who will just give you what he wants to give you and no more. You'll get no more out of him. It's just like, you know, you ask him something, that's it, or he'll go round the houses. He's not interested in entertaining the press or anything like that. And he's entitled to be that way if he's not being obstructive or rude, but he won't offer anything. That's his style of management. Yeah. Probably his generation where he comes from as well. People forget how advanced Stevie is, and maybe in relationship to to other managers, not just in years, but in the level of where he was working for big clubs with big managers, every word would be a prisoner because it would be a sentence. You know, imagine if he said something, you know, like, you know, and he didn't say this, dear listener, but imagine if he said one day, you know, Jose can be off a crabbit at times. Well, that's a back page in a spread. You know, people, you know, Clark slams Jose, you know, his attitude, etc., etc., etc. So he's obviously because of that heightened thing, which would be world news. It's Jose Mourinho, you know. Jose, you know, Jose's number two has a take on the angry man that is the Portuguese special one and all that, so he knows that, so he's not going to give hostages to fortune, because again he's a clever, a lot of these guys are clever as well, which people don't really realise.
They don't appreciate that. The other thing, I was reading it recently actually in a book about Fergus McCann, and I know that you weren't working within the sports kind of arena at that time, but you may have been aware of it, Hugh, how Fergus was unhappy with some of the reporting prior to the takeover, sending Hersey's to Celtic Park, etc. And he, I think, got all the press in a room and basically explained how it was going to be from now on. What was the story with that? Did you hear any?
Fergus was very, and I say properly as well, suspicious of the press. But you've got to remember, though, Fergus, again, was clever. And, yeah, he was suspicious of the press and lots of elements of the press as well. Particularly because that was the time of David Murray, and a lot of people, press had great relationships with David Murray, which we'll go into in a minute. So he knew the script. He knew that that Celtic were perceived as a struggling little club that that was heading for oblivion, and this strange Canadian Croy man, you know, alighting on their steps. Looking back, what an incredible thing. You know, looking back, just saying to yourself, if you took a snapshot of, you know, what was going on then, and you look back in it now through the prism, absolutely astonishing. What McCann did, which was precisely what he said he would do, what he believed, what was going on at Rangers, which was now precisely what was going on at Rangers. I mean, this guy, and that's a guy I've had a fraught relationship as well with, but if you're talking about prescient, if you're talking about being bang on the money, if you're talking about being sincere and authentic, I mean, you're talking 100 out of 100. Absolutely 100, you know, like no side to him on that. So, yeah, he knew he had to address real strong matters in the press, what people might call inherent bias towards Rangers. There was certainly a strong element in the press then of Rangers supporting journalists. But there's also a strong element in the press of people knowing that Rangers was a great story, and then like keeping, people are not keeping in with Murray at that time because they liked him, or they or even if they might have been or might not have been Rangers support, they're keeping in with him because he could give you great stories. You could phone him at 11 o'clock at night and say, yeah, we're signing Terry Butcher. Now if you're going back to your gaffer and you're saying, David Murray's just told me they're signing Terry Butcher, you know, you're a happy man, your mortgage is paid for another month, things like that. And Murray was very clever enough to spread these little bits of gold dust around different journalists. Kept guys, and he always answered the phone. Fergus took another attitude. Fergus distanced himself to the phone, partly maybe, I don't know, I'd be speaking for him, partly maybe a suspicion of the press, partly an innate and personal aversion to talking to the press, which is maintained even and now. But it'd be wrong to say he couldn't work the press, because what you've got to remember is that people in Celtic were changing. He was smart. So he may not have engaged the press, but it'd be ludicrous to say the press didn't play a great part in Ferguson's takeover. And he'd guys smart enough that people have forgotten that did engage the press. I mean, there's press guys very, very to the fore in Celtic for Change, and you know, and Fergus had guys like Matt McGlone and other people there that could engage the press and get the press on their side. Dempsey, the same, who was a great pal of a lot of press men, so he could bring them on board. So that bypassed antipathy toward, and there was an antipathy in certain quarters to Rangers, to Celtic and Ferguson, that bypassed it. So that was cute as well. Although, so maybe Ferguson wasn't involved in it, but he was certainly aware of it, and he knew that his message was getting out in another way.
This is just going back to a point that we spoke about before. The share issue, you know, launching the share issue on the back of a Coca-Cola Cup defeat against Raith Rovers. And interestingly enough, David Lowe spoke about that precise moment where Fergus has looked out his office window, and it was the office that used to be Terry Cassidy's office.
That's right.
He said, and he could see the queue of people queuing right around, right out of view. And at that moment, Fergus McCann realised the magnitude of what he had taken on.
Yep. It's a moment. All you need to that was you're describing it as the swelling strings of Hollywood orchestra, and the direction of Frank Capra, you know, in the black and white film, looking out on this, isn't it? I mean, it's like it's a wonderful life. This guy's going. He says he's all in, Fergus, on an idea, and he's a guy as well that if he goes all in and it comes up kaput, he doesn't walk away. One of the great untold stories about Fergus, well, it's not untold, but it's maybe forgotten, is that in his early business venture, I think it's pretty famous that he broadcast a Celtic game and he lost money on it. What's not known is that 5 years later, or 6 years later, he was chapping doors and handing over cheques to people who'd lost money on that.
Right.
Not 40 pence in the pound, not 10 pence in the pound, a pound in the pound. And sometimes with interest. That's a fact, and you can take it that Fergus McCann didn't tell me that, because Fergus McCann wouldn't tell you a ghost story. And Fergus McCann wouldn't really tell you what, but I know this is to be true. So he knew if he was in for what he was in for, he's going to lose it. And if he lost it, it was lost. He couldn't go and say, oh, Hugh lost it, or Nick's guy lost it, the guy didn't matter. And if it was gone. It was gone. It was a lot of money. It was a lot of his personal money. But the great thing about Fergus McCann is that everything he said he did, he would do, he would do. And some of that didn't later. You've got to remember, a lot of that didn't go down well with Celtic supporters, Paul. This great now beatification of the blessed Fergus at the time. That's not the case.
They
booed him later, but even at the time, why are we not signing this man? And the Celtic Rangers have signed in that. Why can't we not sign this? Oh, I wish he would get his hands out of his pockets. And oh, we're going to lose Van Hooydonk, and Cadetti, and De Canio. And there's huge ructions about that.
Yeah.
But he did what he said he would do. But we talked about this, the narrative of the club is really important. And what he got almost viscerally, I think, although he didn't know it was going to happen, but I think most Celtic supporters would know this viscerally, to know the narrative of the club. And I think he knew that when push came to shove, Celtic supporters would smash the piggy bank. And that's what happened. People,
quite literally,
yeah. People were going in under beds and into wee bank accounts that they had for rainy days and taking out £273.47. You know, huge sums like that for people, and coming along with it. Astonishing story. And it's what sustained the club, because it rescued it from what was a deeply adversarial bank. It rescued them from that. And then it laid the template of what was to come. That was it. This was the way the Celtic were going to do things from then on. Then they were going to have people on the board. I mean, Celtic's financial health here is a matter of some luck at times, you know, because you get Champions League where maybe you shouldn't, and you get. But it's not a matter of fortune. There's no fortune in how the club is run. The club is run in certain strong tenets. There's a reason why Celtic shied away from EBTs. There's a reason why Celtic are in the black. There's a reason why people on the Celtic board were at one time deputy governor of the Bank of England, or involved in high finance around the world. These are guys that are coming onto a very professionally run board. You know, there's like there is no room for a wing and a prayer stuff there. This is now as a PLC, as you know, it's governed by business law as well. But and Fergus laid all that down, and the people that came aboard, he had enough about him to get people aboard. I mean, I think Brian Quinn, for example, one of the major figures in Celtic history that flies under the radar. I think Quinn hugely important to what happened to Celtic in the 21st century. Mm-hmm. I think Peter Lowell, again a guy who
has divided opinion, isn't
and it? Still does, yeah. And still does, hugely mm-hmm. vilified in some sense, has been one of the, he's now become one of the leading European figures in European football. People forget. That's another thing that seems to have flown under the radar, how high he is in the European Clubs Association. To be Celtic manager, mm-hmm. Celtic chief executive, and be moving and shaking there. He's really... But that all came from being stable, from having a business plan, for saying this is who we are and this is what we go forward. And I think the great thing as well, it brought into the narrative of the club where people said, you know, this is our club. This just can't go. This is not just about this, that, and this. It's not even about Lisbon. You know that? It's not even about Scottish Cup finals. This is about Celtic Football Club, what it means to me as a human being, what it means to me as a matter of my identity, of who I am. So it's got to be there. It's got to, and it's got, and we've got to just support it. And McCann, of course, I don't know if you heard this, but he had a great distinction. He always said to me, "Are you a Celtic fan? Are you a Celtic supporter? I'm only interested in you if you're a Celtic supporter." And his point was, if anybody can be a fan, mm-hmm. a supporter's the guy who puts his hand in his pocket.
Yeah. And the thing is, he did sell the club to us, because I remember in my cohort on this podcast was the exact same. Our first season tickets were under Fergus McCann for the 94-95 season, mm-hmm. when we basically played every game as an away game at Hampden,
yeah.
And it was a pretty poor season. Yeah, it was a dreadful season, actually. But he introduced the idea to a then 15-year-old myself, you can buy a season ticket.
Mm-hmm.
And then you actually felt when you bought that season ticket, I couldn't afford shares at that time because I was a paper boy, but I could afford a season ticket. And you were a supporter then, and you were investing in this vision that Fergus McCann had. So you got that buy-in.
But it's an incredible vision. Mm-hmm. See, I'm being a Celtic supporter. I've watched Celtic, and I've got no qualms about saying I'm a Celtic supporter. So you're a journalist. How can you say you're that? It's just stupid. It's who I am. I've watched Celtic in seven different decades. I've watched them in the 50s right through to now. But what was me? I used to be a member of a supporters bus before journalism meant that I had to work Saturdays. I had to work nights. So you just couldn't, you know. But I would say in that bus being Eagle, some supporters bus, where there's guys who had been going for decades, and guys, by the way, they would go to every single game. There was a bus ran to every game. So if it was a broth on a Wednesday night, guys would take time off their work, you know, cut their work early to run along and get the bus at 3 o'clock for Kilmarnock Road and get up to a broth. I would say all these guys, maybe hundreds and hundreds of years of Celtic supporting that bus, not one of them would have a season ticket. Not one. Guys go every single match.
Because
there's no such thing as season tickets. Season tickets were for priests or businessmen. We never saw people get into season ticket book. A season ticket book would be like if you took one of them onto the Antiques Roadshow now, for them, be one of the great artifacts of Celtic's history. Very few people bought about two reasons for that. There wasn't a culture for it. Second reason, you could walk up to any game, get in. I mean, see, the only games that you had to bother about, the European games, okay, you had to bother about a ticket then, and obviously a Rangers game, you'd have to bother about a ticket in a cup final to a certain extent, but cup final tickets were easy. It was over 100,000 at a cup final. But what I'm trying to say, that by and large, Celtic, what people forget is McCann was saying, I've got this really crap team at the moment, right, that's getting duffed up by the top rivals, right? They're duffing us up. Don't know how they're doing it. Don't know how they're affording it. But I'm telling you, I can't afford it. So I don't know where they're going, but we can't afford this. So you know what? We might have been getting duffed up quite a lot. Second has, you've got a crap stadium, so I can't really give you you know, a nice seat in it. But what I'm going to give you is this beautiful stadium. And see, like, as a Celtic fan, I know when Celtic were winning 9 in a row, we were getting 30,000. But I'm going to say to you, this is a really crap team we've got, and the expectations aren't high that there'll be a really good team, is it? But I want 60,000 of you to come along every week. Now that's, come on, I mean, if you're sitting down, as I'm saying, see if you're looking back through history, especially if you're my age who's been through it before it, during it, and after it, you're going, 60,000 at a Celtic game every week, like Ross County. You're saying there'll be 60,000 at Ross County first? Aye, we'll go for that. Yeah, sure. I mean, I used to watch Kenny Dalglish. I mean, Ross County had been the hell in the league, but I used to watch Kenny Dalglish against a very good Motherwell team with Willie Pettigrew, a very good Dundee United team that was getting European finals, and maybe 28,000 of us there, Fergus.
Magical figure always seemed to be 26,000.
even with the gentle massage on it. I mean, there certainly wasn't. It wasn't a full stadium, was it?
No.
So, for him to do that, I still look back in Fergus with, you know, a sense of awe and a sense of incredulity almost. And I'm, as I say, I've got, he's a very singular human being as well. He's, but interestingly, I've interviewed a lot of people, and I've come to know an awful lot of people who were about him at the time, who worked with him at the time. And the respect's not high enough a word. It's almost reverence towards him. Yeah, they reckon that he would be, if the decision was come to, he would back them on it. He might not like the decision. They may argue against it, but once the decision was made and he decided to go with the person, see if it all went wrong. He never came back and said, I told you that was not. He believed that once he had agreed with you as chief exec and pushed it forward, it was never to, as a putative owner of the club, once he'd agreed with you and that strategy, it was his strategy. So if it failed, it wasn't your fault for persuading him. It was him.
Mm-hmm.
There was a real degree of responsibility. And people, well, you've interviewed guys like David Lowe and all that who know him 100 million times better than I do. I mean, I don't know the man at all. I've only spoken to him on a few occasions. And these guys are not daft. I mean, these guys have been around the block a few times. And their level of, as I say, comment on him, you know, he's obviously a really remarkable man.
And it's 25 years next year.
Yeah, and great, great story. Great part of the Celtic's full of great stories, isn't it? But all the, I always think of that aforementioned David Lowe, you know, sitting in farms, helping guys milk cows and Donegal or whatever it was, and saying, give us the proxy on your share and all that. Mm-hmm. Great stories. Mm-hmm. And again, just the sheer madness of it all. Let's tell people that they can all go and watch in a 60,000-seated stadium a team that's just been duffed up by Raith Rovers in a cup final. Yeah, everybody will buy into that, Fergus. Here we are.
Going
have you ever done an interview like this yet?
This is good. This is what we talked about. It's life experience. What I'm really looking forward to is this, and you can keep include this in your podcast, is driving up the M8 with me holding a microphone and people looking and saying, God, he really is a media slut. Not only does he appear in Ruffy and BBC and everything else, he actually does interviews in a car
on the road
to see his grandwin. I like that.